Oh, we're not going to put a Baja printout up there?
No. We don't have time for that. Huh. We just got to get this in the can.
Yeah. Right? It's true. Sometimes we have to do things. Look what came in my mailbox this morning.
USPS tracking.
This was all shoved in my little tiny cube. I had to rip this to get it out. Wow. The mailman
just like, jammed it.
You couldn't have put it in the big box. Like, where is it full? All our neighbors are getting weed across state lines too, or what? Oh, sorry. Whoops.
Arizona is a wildly beautiful place, brimming with over 100 brewing companies. I'm Rob Fulmer, the executive director of the Arizona Craft Brewers Guild. I'm joined by Deputy Director Andrew Bauman. Together, we cover the state, bringing you the best of what's happening at our breweries and beyond. Welcome to Arizona Beer Frontier.
Wow. The mailman
just like, jammed it.
You couldn't have put it in the big box. Like, where is it full? All our neighbors are getting weed across state lines too, or what? Oh, sorry. Whoops.
What is that?
Okay, so while I was watching the Super Bowls, I had a Facebook ad pop up that said, it's time for, would you like to grab, okay, I had like 800 ads come up that said, oh, you've purchased a hemp-based THC product in the past. Would you like to buy some? Here's a free sample.
Right.
I said, yeah, great. They said, would you like to have 60 more for $20? I said, yes.
Okay, there we go.
So all of this came in the mailbox. And this is the one that had no requirement for are you 18 or anything.
Right.
Now they, it may only be advertised to a certain age group on the Book of Face.
Yeah.
But anyone can go to that link, right?
Right.
The great thing is, look at the lid.
Closed tightly.
It's a tamper-proof lid.
Well, yeah. I mean, sure. I don't need to open
you
your stuff.
You have to push it.
Yeah, I got it. I got it. All of that is. So these are all hemp-based. These are all hemp-based products shipped through the United States Postal Service and or UPS.
Just USPS. That's it. Straight up.
They're saving money that way.
I know. So lucky.
It would be really great if we could do that with beer.
Ah, that's silly.
Yeah, it's silly.
Beer's heavy, bro.
Hey.
Hi, Rob.
Sick beer week, bro.
It's real sick.
Sick. So the official beverage for me today is water. I have been under the weather, stomach flu, since Friday night.
You had it real bad.
Yes. I was at the Strong Beer Festival. I did have three ounce samples of something. I drank a lot of water and some NAs, but not the beer kind, just some of the
coconut water.
Some of the recovery waters. Yeah. I had an IV.
180 recovery. Thank you for being there.
I had an IV.
Yeah. Brother said that you felt a lot better after
it
that.
It did. I'm a believer. But I had some sort of stomach flu. And after I left there, I did not leave my house or my bedroom and the adjacent bathroom for, I don't know, 48 hours?
Yeah, wow.
So there was some sort of stomach flu. I've heard other people have had variations of this. You also.
I did. Mine was much more mild than yours.
Yeah.
Mine was being uncomfortable, feeling off, and we don't need to get in specifics, but mine was less than yours,
right.
But yeah. Still not good, and it definitely kept me down.
I heard one of the distributors talk about it, and Brenda was suggesting that some somehow we had done the same thing, or we were, we hadn't really been near each other for most since Wednesday.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which I don't know, like 1 to 2 days before, possibly. I don't know how to even diagnose the window. I just, you know.
I mean, it came on with you like hard.
Yeah.
Mine definitely was just like a slow roll that got a little bit worse, but never really got awful.
Right, right. So I left the baseball game on Friday feeling, I had definitely just stopped doing anything, consuming anything, even water. I was just like, I'm not really feeling that great. And went to the attic for quails night before Arizona Strong Beer. And then Scott Hendricks got a beer for me. I had about a sip and I said, you know, I got to pull the plug. I just got to leave. I don't know what's going on. So anyway, missed Andrew Bauman.
Hey, Rob.
We didn't do that.
I said, hey, Rob, you just didn't catch it.
Oh, really?
It's
see?
Okay.
I missed the post fest thing. I usually try to get one or two events after that. I missed the Brewers Breakfast. I missed the Sierra Nevada Disc Tournament. I missed the bike ride with Santan. I mean, those are things I haven't missed in 10 years.
Yeah.
So
I went to the Santam breakfast. It was super nice. They was very busy. They were so hospitable. They must have had 15 staff members there taking care of everyone. They did a bingo activation that looked really nice. The whole layout was gorgeous. I got home from that, and then we took a 3-hour nap.
Mm.
And when I woke up, I was like, huh, I don't really feel awesome. I think I'm going to chill. And then Monday morning, I woke up. I went to the Sierra Nevada Disc Golf. Was not feeling great. Again, they were so nice and greeted everyone, so generous. And they had a taco truck there. I had one little taco. I ate half of it and I was like, no, something's not cool. I finished the round and then I was immediately bolted.
Wow.
Like I didn't stay for anyone else. We were one of the first ones done. We passed two other groups
because
I was with the super golfers.
The A team.
So I was way ahead of everyone else getting there. I took off and went home and just sat on the couch, didn't eat a single thing, sipped on water for 36 hours. It was sucky.
Yeah.
Slept on the couch. It's pretty comfortable. Bonnie came out, slept with me. The dogs are out there. It's nice. Other than not being near my wife, which I do. I do like cuddling. Yeah.
Yeah. I just, you know, even after at no time did I feel like nauseous in the head. It was just not staying in my body and going out in
any way it wanted to.
Yeah. And
I used a phrase to explain it to my wife that I will not use here. And she was like, oh, wow.
And, you know, you're supposed to hydrate, but I felt like every sip of water was like, 10 times the volume once it went in. It just, so I don't know. They say, I mean, if it's multiple days, it's some sort of flu or
right.
Some sort of infection. So I don't know. I feel better today.
Maybe we had the same thing, but because I drink my emergency every morning, I just
maybe
had a
that's
less
it.
Of an effect.
Maybe.
Because that was super strong.
I want to believe in that.
System.
I want to believe in that. I'm only going to choose not to, so you aren't responsible for giving me that every day.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you will.
I did bring Sierra Nevada Trail Pass non-alcoholic golden ale
right.
with me back from the event, and it is so yummy, and I dig it. And I'm the one that goes for the IPAs, right? But this is like really, really good.
Hmm.
So, sorry you can't have any, Harry.
No, I can.
Oh, there's a little in there.
Taste. Still a little sweet, but I'm all right with it.
Yum.
So the festival. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Brilliant weather. Best weather ever. It's still, I mean, the sun, the actual sun hitting your skin is a thing. So you can still get warm. I think most people were comfortable, but if you're not hydrating and you're, you know, if you overdid it early, I mean, it's going to catch up with you. So you got to be careful. Nice cool breeze every time the wind blew, right? The setup, 25% bigger. So it might have felt a little less dense, but that's okay. I actually prefer that level of crowdedness because if you wanted to be in, feel like that wasn't the case, you just walk into one of the areas and it's fine. I think it's weird because people have, when you change something like that, people have all kinds of weird perceptions about, you know, I think we had about the same crowd number about, I don't know.
Yes.
Like, I'm not going to pretend.
We do not have the exact numbers yet. Right. Our partners at Salt River Field started their spring training season today.
Right.
And have been incredibly busy working on that.
Right.
And so we're giving them a little grace and understanding that everyone goes through a lot of stuff right. when you're kicking off.
I know there are some individual notes that we received. There are going to be people who say one thing, and I could point to a similar amount of people who say the opposite. It you know, in terms of like, we should try this, we should try that. That's fine. That's fine. All I'm going to say is kudos to you and the Salt River Fields team and some of the people who were involved early in the decision making, because I don't think we could have presented a better product. I think that's definitely the new standard. Going forward. So if those conditions are repeated, even to the 85% level, you know, I think most customers will see it as a win. And the only thing they'll be questionable about is the weather, in which we don't control. So, you know, we just got to get more people in there. If this is, well, because it is a fundraiser for this organization, if we're going to not see those people come in because we can't encourage them from our breweries to be there or to reach, to make a conscious, huge spend probably to get a whole new host of people to come, because it is expensive to do that, then I think we have to sort of understand that we need to do heavier lifting on our other events and or other streams of revenue,
yeah,
including changing our due structure.
I think we need to look at potentially changing the juice structure. Most states have it based on the number of barrels produced. Okay, that's something to look at. We need to do Pint Day. We need to do our Title IV book. We need to do every little thing we can because...
Right.
Yeah.
And all those things kind of take away from... a lot of those things take away from providing services to our members.
Yeah, we can't. There's only so many hours in a day. And to be honest, like, you and I don't have, there's no forward path of growth other than improving the system we have here. If we were to double the number of members we have through our work on legislation mm-hmm. and through our work of promoting breweries, that would be amazing, and that would potentially be a path to growth for what would be our careers. That's a very unlikely scenario. You know, a 10% growth up in this year would be awesome. 10% mm-hmm. growth over that next year, also incredible. We're not going to see that happen for a long time. Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting organization to fund.
Right. So we'll just leave it at that. I do have some updates on the bills that we have running. The festival bill in terms of exempting inspection from municipalities and other agencies, that got through the committee. That should be on its way to a House floor vote. We're happy about that. The omnibus bill, which we don't have any steam in or any issues in, is moving along fine. We voiced our objections and got some language taken out, so we're comfortable with that. Despite that, ironically, there's an event during Beer Week that had plenty of time to get their extension of premise approved. It did not get approved. So after Beer Week, we're going to zero in on that municipality. It has nothing. It's ironic because the last thing you want is to agree to allow the cities to have more leeway with that and then have this happen at the same time. Not related necessarily, but we do need to work on that. And then we have the hemp bill, and that did not go well for us in the House. We still have the Senate vehicle. We still think that can move forward. I actually have some time with KJZZ's The Show tomorrow. I don't know when that produced piece will air to talk about it a little bit, but we had a situation where we moved the committee from one committee to another, to the committee where the bill sponsor had a seat. So you're going to get a vote that way. And, you know, I have a feeling that the much more moneyed dispensary lobby was able to outmaneuver and get to those committee members. So our testimony didn't matter. I'm trying to forgive and forget on this one a little bit. But for me to walk in and say I represent 100 breweries, and also we were able to enlist the support of the Arizona Restaurant Association and the Arizona Licensed Beverage Association, thereby having about 15,000 licenses, if you include all the special events and all that stuff, on our side, and get 30 seconds of testimony. And I had to compete with, a lot of fear-mongering, a lot of things that were concerns that are happening today in the market.
Right now, happening right here.
Right. Yes, we're concerned about that too. But this is the only bill that has regulations in it to help change that.
Until, yeah, and if it doesn't pass, then we're going to get to next year.
Yeah.
And so, then next year it'll be a whole nother thing, and we'll have 12 more months of a completely unregulated market.
Exactly. Yeah. So,
hey, look, I think less regulation is good as a philosophical point, but I also don't think that having these completely unregulated is a good idea.
We had you weren't there. I barely managed to attend that. I went to we helped organize a sort of a hemp mixer. There were a lot of folks from out of state. I met one of the suppliers. They do other kind of adjuncts for breweries in Minnesota. They are one of the suppliers of the THC from hemp.
What's the name of it? Is it Abstracts?
I don't know the name of the company. I probably shouldn't mention him. Well, his name is Frank.
Oh, now it's over. You know his name's Frank.
Well, I don't know. Like, he flew out for this, and he is a strong supporter of the Minnesota Brewers Guild. So he's like, we're pulling for you. Is there something I could do? Hopefully we can pull him as a member at some point as we get to that. But met some folks from other out-of-state hemp-based both beverage producers and other hemp associated industries. They feel like this is a great market for them. And you know, here's the thing, like it goes unregulated, and I talked to somebody, and I won't tell you who it is, but if they're a bigger concern, he's like, you know, we have the cash, we just need an in, and we're gonna come in here and we're gonna fight the lawsuit if need be. And so, you know, you're looking at, in very real time, what happened to the beer industry. Like, there was decades of out-of-state breweries, out-of-state liquor companies, out-of-state wineries. I mean, consider there wasn't a winery industry here before, who just, you know, have a foothold and they get an implant. So, like, I do value their input. I do value the fact that they are on our side. They're on it for their own reasons. They're good partners for the time being. And if we can sort of come into the market at the same time, even though they're much more resourced, I feel like that's great.
We're in a different direction than they are, though.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, this is why it's important. You know, another year of not regulation, you know, they're just kind of waiting at the border here to do this. And, you know, I want to give our local suppliers, breweries, or anyone the opportunity to get into this if they so choose before that really becomes a thing. You know, and distributors want that too. Like there's a couple of distributors, like they can't officially weigh in, but they want to engage. They want to, they want to work with their current partners if they're going to get in that space. So I don't know.
A lot of distributors are getting to other than alcohol distribution as it is.
Right.
They're bringing on a lot more NA brands. They're diversifying.
Right.
Whoa, imagine diversifying when your industry starts getting pretty jacked because of things outside your control that you want to diversify and find other revenue streams. And they're doing that in one way. They have to be very careful how they do it in this way, but I would imagine they would find it.
Right, right. So all very encouraging people. They were very thankful that we put this together for the opportunity to meet each other, find out what we got going on in the state. A lot of them pledged even monetary support, and I'm like, we're not there. And this is really the Hemp Industry Trade Association of Arizona. I think they're the ones that have been running this bill for 2 years. Nevertheless, we get to next year, and we're still in a behind the eight ball. We might have to reformulate that because we're not going to devote resources indiscriminately. This was just kind of a we caught this midstream. Anyway, very very encouraged by that. They were they thought Arizona Wilderness, where we had this, was wonderful. So I would like to thank them personally for providing that. I had to dip out of that early. I'm only good for about 1 4-ounce, 8-ounce beer these days right now because I'm still on the bubble. We have the women's wrestling, arm wrestling thing tonight. And, you know, that's something I really look forward to. I will not make it the distance to that tonight. I just want to get healthy for the weekend because I'm going to Flagstaff for that ABV beer dinner.
Right. So,
and I want to be able to, eat all those
consume
things.
Consume something. Something.
Yeah. Yeah.
I got a cucumber and a banana for breakfast. I sent a picture because Bonnie was like, you have to have a banana. And I really don't like bananas.
I hear potassium is good for this. Apples are too. So I had an apple.
So she said, hey, heads up, cucumbers can be rough in the stomach. I said, damn it. I thought I made the right choices.
I don't know. I thought that was good too.
I don't know. Anyways.
Yeah.
Hey, let's get back on to beer.
Okay.
So the National American Homebrew Association.
Yes.
Said that they are going to take a break on the National Homebrew Conference and
Brewcon. What do they call it?
HomebrewCon. And they are going to do some educational forum items in conjunction with the Great American Beer Festival.
Yeah.
And so that's a pretty big switch to turn.
Well, let's just wind back because back in September, I think, or August.
Oh, when they had HomebrewCon.
Well, right after. So they've had 2 years of, you know, they want to say a great experience, but declining attendance at Pittsburgh and San Diego. I wasn't there.
Unfortunately, it always coincides with real loud and woodsy.
Or our hill climb.
Or hill climb.
Yeah. In any case, they said they were going to, they didn't really announce it. It just was kind of heard around the block that they were going to combine it with GABF. And I was like, I don't think this is a great idea because I think you're going to make it more expensive for both parties to attend. It's already an expensive endeavor in Denver. And, you know, depending on which figures you want to read it, to have, you know, a couple, 3 or 4,000, maybe 5,000 more attendees and to that.
In the same town with the same hotels and right. the same restaurants and the same cabs and the same Ubers. And
right. Yeah. I just didn't see it. And you know, so they said that, didn't provide any details. And yesterday they said, oh, it's not really going to be a conference. It's going to be a series of exhibitions, and they will, I've heard conflicting things. I listened to the All About Beer podcast with John Hall. We had Julia Herz on. They still didn't really nail what I think they're going to do. And there was a question of whether actual homebrew would be present. I heard it wasn't. And then I heard there will be a couple of homebrew icons that will pour their own beer. I'm not really sure how that's going to work. Is that just another pro-am or is that a...
I don't know.
So there's a lot of questions. And
She did say that Julia Herz is the director of the American Homebrewer Association.
Right.
She did say that they are going to have educational forums, which are exclusive to the homebrew members.
Right.
And that also they would have things that were encouraging people that are attending GABF to become homebrewers. So it's kind of a combo, collab, promotion, marketing, which right. I don't think that's a bad thing. I think it's the homebrew community definitely is going to feel slighted.
I agree. And, you know, I've read when the story came out, I read some things, comments, and since that podcast came out, like literally yesterday, there's been a whole host of more comments.
I only saw it this morning, so.
You know, a lot of people feel like it was too big, and the Brewers Association will agree that the locations were harder and harder to do affordably. So there might be something to that. I don't know. You know,
we know how hard it is to do a large event right. and how expensive it is. And
yeah. I mean, you know, having the right scale is important. That's true. But it's really hard to predict. It's really hard to design when you have people who just really don't want to commit. The you know, also like the underwriters of those events, they want to see bigger numbers, right? I mean, exclusive is fine, but that doesn't mean a lot if the number of people that you can reach with yeah. your product.
Bob's Hop Company doesn't want to have 5,000 people that he's paying $10,000 to be a sponsor at last year and now get only 4,000 this year and still have to pay 10 grand.
Right, right. And these things are cyclical and it's difficult to sort of, yes. I mean,
I think Julia went through the homebrew cycle, community cycle pretty well. I mean, it's obvious to us in the business how it works and us, because we're still very connected to homebrew. I mean, a lot more than many professional brewers are.
That's true.
So we get that picture more than many people. And maybe it means more to us than people listening to the show. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, it's certainly it's data. It's a prevailing indicator of something, right? It's not,
Is it a leading indicator? As homebrew goes down, then you have a 3-year lag and craft beer starts losing numbers? I don't know.
Yeah, I had this discussion about hemp, by the way, and I said, hey, you know, generation THC hemp, and like someone said, and mushrooms, like, well, that might be possible too.
Oh my God, mushrooms, forget about it. That is going to crush in the next 5 years.
So 20 years from now, 10 years from now, all those people like will reinvent craft beer or homebrewing yeah. or distilling or whatever.
Yeah.
So it's just a matter of time.
I was one of the original homebrewers back in 1997.
You're doing the voice. What is that? Mid-century? No, mid-Atlantic accent.
You're welcome.
It's very universal. Very it's
new to me.
1940s newsreel.
I just came up with it first time. okay, so that is a thing that we have to keep our eye on is what does that really mean? I'm sure in the next couple of weeks that there's going to be a lot of pressure to clarify these things because it's getting out in the
world. They have to start selling tickets in June for October. Yeah, so I don't know. It's going to be a bumpy ride, I think, for THA and Julia. And I'm a lifetime member, and I probably shouldn't get involved. But I think there's some, again, based on the comments, they're like, well, we should be able to do our own regional thing. I'm like, there's nothing stopping you. And John Hall pointed to the guilds conferences and like, all right, well, that is a thing for maybe 10, 15 states at that scale.
Right.
We're having our difficulties reconstituting ours as a slightly above the fold of the newspaper state on these things.
I think he also, I think one, and I'm speaking completely in my own head, I think maybe what he meant was clubs, not necessarily guilds, like homebrew clubs having conferences.
Right. No. He was saying state guilds.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that clubs should be able to. And there's nothing wrong with that. I think that's good. He pointed to the state guild competitions and I don't know, the whole regional thing came up again. And I'm like, I don't know. I think there's a lot of willingness, but there's not a lot of structure to do those kinds of things. Although a couple of people pointed out they had something like that in the Pacific Northwest. And I mean, I think those are all healthy things and I think they improve. I mean, I don't think the AHA is going to look at that as competition. I think they will be excited for any kind of structured educational formats that promote the craft, the hobby of homebrewing. You know, for the same reason, you know, we want our breweries to do these kinds of things, that reach out and do more things that intersect with things that we also can do, like educational things. And, you know, I know there's probably a subtext of, hey, we do festivals and any other festival, you know, should die the death of 1,000 paper cuts if it's not ours. It's not necessarily true, but, you know, we want those festivals to be improved, and we do.
We want them to be a good example of what craft beer fans should see, because any festival that's out there that does a bad job, and I'm thinking of one in particular that I've heard so many people complain about.
Yeah.
They're still going to do it next year. They're still going to have new people come to it. They're still going to have the same breweries show up to it, and they can continue doing a bad job.
Yeah. Exactly.
And now I'm ready to sign off. Thank you, everybody.
No, and it's like we take meetings with people all the time and it's like, hey, I got this great idea, and we, you know, and then we don't hear from them. And, you know, if they want us to be involved, then I mean, honestly, we just need to be able to be compensated for that on behalf of this organization. Not because like, oh, well, you know,
I want a consulting fee.
Right. No. it's like this organization needs that kind of resource, and we provide more experience and resource than anybody out there. So
and advice of how to do good things, and I don't know.
Yeah. There you have it.
What happened?
I think we're about to have our most concise show ever.
It's the quickest show we've ever had because we got stuff to do. It's beer week, yo.
Yeah.
We have Baja Beer Fest coming up. The sign up for that went out today to our through our member brewery newsletter. Mm-hmm. So that's out there now. And we have Real Wild and Woodsy coming up in June in Flagstaff. And we have what's between now and then? That's it, right? We have those two.
We got an evening in Prague thing cooking, but we don't have a detail. That's this is in April. I think the first weekend in March is Beaver Street's 30th anniversary. Is that?
That's right.
So,
It's Flagstaff Beer Co. and Beaver Street together. Beaver Street was awarded one of the top 100 pizza places in the country by Yelp.
Okay.
Very exciting. So my son, he works there. He's very excited. He was like, that's cool.
Right on.
Or he said something better than that, though. He said that. However they say it.
As we are at the Wednesday, for everyone listening, Thursday of Beer Week, any thoughts on how this one's going, even though we were kind of not really involved?
I do have a lot of thoughts on that.
Okay.
I have been far more involved in the back end side of it than I was last year. I don't know why that is. I don't know if everyone put their things in, but there are a lot more events than there were last year.
Yeah.
I'm getting a lot more feedback on social media, like Meta business site where you get messages and comments. A lot more of those going through. So I don't know if that just means that our social media is having better algorithm movement or if people are actually saying things and doing things.
Yeah, I would say there was a lot of excitement about Strong from breweries much later, but still good to see. And there were a lot, I think a lot of that was kind of late for Beer Week in terms of getting events in, but I think there was some excitement and I wish we would have had another month to sort of get ahead of that. Not us. I mean, just having,
we don't know about the events until the events show up on the calendar. Yeah.
Right. It's hard to promote them. It's hard to talk about them.
Yeah.
And, you know, like when I get asked the question in December and January, when we do long leads, which are print and all that stuff, I have to look, literally assume that some of the historic events are going to occur, and it doesn't always happen. So,
but this year, Bottle Shop 48 moved their chili cook-off from Monday to Tuesday, or from Sunday. It used to be Sunday after Arizona Strong. They moved it to Tuesday, so it didn't compete with other things, and they kind of had their own magic day. And then,
there's going to be answers for that. I think. We've collected enough data. We've had enough experience. I've talked to enough people who might help underwrite Arizona Beer Week much more thoroughly. So I this is an organization that tries to lift all of our members up. At some point, you have to say, we're not going to find you. You just have to find us. And we just have to move forward with the people who are on board. Once in a while we leave the boat at the dock too long, and we gotta stop doing that. I just think we have to move forward with what we know. And if I can get a couple of those people to commit to these events, at least in theory, we can get the Arizona Office of Tourism behind us. We get the local convention and visitors bureaus or destination marketing organizations, what they're called. So like Visit Flagstaff, who, by the way, I don't know if you've noticed, have done an excellent job. They have
They have a
contest. They take a lot of pride in
they
it.
They brand Flagstaff as Arizona's beer city.
Yeah.
And you know what? No one else is competing with them.
Right.
So if they say it, long enough and loud enough, they get to do it. Tucson.
Well, I mean, we have some partners down there who are dying to have their own space carved out for it, and I get their point. And
then,
because they want to travel, they want to do the same things that we get to do. They want to have their time and they want to enjoy other people's events. So, all those things are being looked at, and you know, so we're going to have distributors, more distributors input, more retailers input. Obviously, our brewers will have the final say. The destination marketing organizations, you know, I wouldn't even be surprised if we get that group together. They're going to decide, you know, how this should be structured. The platform needs to change. We're just saddled with what we have for the last 10 years. And haven't really found a product that can convey all the things that we want to convey. But if we get all those people together, I wouldn't be surprised if we had some sort of consumer representation in that format. So I'm excited about that. But for the rest of the week, I hope to be back on the beer train Friday or Saturday. I'll be fine. Just having a glass of water and maybe a little beer, and watch the fundraising efforts of our women in the industry. with the arm wrestling thing and
online streaming.
Yeah, there's online streaming.
Oh, it's too late now. It's Thursday.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, it'll be recorded.
Okay.
It'll be recorded. So, anyway, just remember, this is not a beer podcast. This is a podcast about beer.
Oh, that was wonderful. Good job.
That's it. We're done.